Welcome to episode 200 of the SWN podcast. And surprise, surprise, it is about WrestleZone. But that's what you expect when you come to this particular podcast. On this episode, I am joined by the main event of Aberdeen Anarchy in 2023, the year of our Lord. It is, none of us are awake, are we? It is one half, one side of the screen. Where am I? It is the mighty Caleb Valhalla, winner of the 2023 Regal Rumble against Aspen Faith, undisputed WrestleZone champion, winner of last year's Regal Rumble, co-winner of last year's Regal Rumble. I'm joined by both. We're going to speak about Aberdeen Anarchy. We're going to speak about whatever has happened between the last time we spoke to each other, I think December 2021 for Caleb and June last year, I think, for Aspen, possibly. So a lot's happened. You guys have saved the world. You've become the layers, the foundations have been made for the greatest tag team of all time. So, how's everyone doing? It's a good start.
Yeah, can't complain. Can't complain.
I'm alive.
Yes, we're both alive after last night. Are we allowed to say when? Like, does
yes,
everyone
yeah.
know this?
I will say that. Yeah. So this has been recorded April 23rd. So just in case there's more matches announced and we don't speak about them, that's why, because it's going out on Revenge of the Fifth. For all you nerds out there, that's when it's going out, so you can all listen to it and enjoy it and divulge it and that before May 13th, which I'm very excited by, even though this household is now divided because of it. It's a scary time in the Strachan house because of Regal Rumble. So we're all well then. We're all alive.
Yeah, we're victorious last night at the Training Academy.
Yeah.
We do have a question about that, actually, which we'll just dive into it.
Deep end. Questions.
Yeah, why not? It's from everyone. I need to find it now, because he obviously put it in the most awkward place, did Ronan King. There we go. Right, okay. How did it feel to get battered by Ronan King last night?
I don't think I took a single move off of anyone last night. Ronan left with quite a lot of welts all over him, and Dynamite left with a broken nose. So
yeah, that was my bad. I think you really messed up Ronan, and then I took Dynamite's face for a little bit of a runabout. So
a successful night at Jane Academy then.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I did take a dragon suplex on the outside. That wasn't fun, but
so let's go back to the start then, ish, of this journey, and we can tangent as we go along. So as far back as I've got, first conversation or first kind of match that you guys have had was May 2022. So I think you may have, if you did cross paths during the Rumble in for WrestleZone in 2022. No, you're in the match, but I don't think you crossed paths. Well, I don't think Caleb was in long enough to.
No, I was pretty much in and out that year.
I don't think he was. I think he was gone before I came out.
Yeah, that was one of those nights where there was two screams. There was one when of course, yeah, Cole won. Actually, no, there was three. One when Dynamite didn't win, and then I shouted at Dennis, and then Cole won. And I screamed in joy, and there was also Kelly who'd bought your T-shirt, Caleb, and was proudly wearing it after getting hounded by William Sterling twice during, because she was very heavily pregnant, only for you to be in for less than 10 seconds.
Yeah, wasn't to be. Wasn't that year for me. But this year was. So.
This year was. So, yeah, May 2022, Reckless Intent, four-way, involving yourselves, GKL Shannon. I'm trusting Cage Match.
No, you skipped ahead. There was a
right, okay.
We wrestled each other in Tillicutri for Reckless Intent.
That was my Reckless
Before
debut.
That, a singles match.
Yeah. Right, okay. So who won?
Sorry.
Who won
Ranger, that? Ranger Podcast. Podcast is done.
That's it.
You know how well researched these podcasts are.
Just shut it down now.
Just hang on. 13th of May. 13th of May.
I don't know.
That's Tillicutri.
Tillicutri.
It's the four-way.
No, that was the second one. So it must have been the year before.
Till October 2021.
Thank you.
There we go. Kiel Valhalla defeated Aspen Faith by pinfall.
Correct.
Yeah. Well, this actually weights better in Kiel's favour then. So October, cut all that. October 30th, 2021, you had your first match against each other. Was Caleb winning. And then May 2022, there was no winner because Shekel Sham won. And then January 2023, nothing in between there. Was that, are we all right? Are we all good? Nothing?
I don't know.
Okay.
I can't remember.
FCW. Yeah, there we go.
FCW. Won.
Yeah.
And then February 2023, Disco. Nobody won because it was a double DQ. So,
yeah.
And it comes to the tail of the tape here.
Hell yeah.
Caleb's got the advantage.
I mean, I really don't know why they ended that match.
Yeah. Safety of the ref, I guess.
So, I mean, I haven't seen the
film. We were having fun. We were having fun.
You can just man up.
Yeah.
Toughen up.
So, from that point onwards, though, because then you probably brawled to the outside. And then you went to the telco box.
Yeah.
And the world was a little bit weird. So
yeah, but whose fault was that, though? Let's be realistic here.
Well, when I watched it, I think
what happened?
I think someone that's not yourself. Hit the buttons and
and someone who isn't myself put me into a phone box, and someone who isn't myself pressed some buttons. They probably
it was a very small phone box. I can't remember the last time I've been in a phone box. That was an experience itself.
It smelled bad.
Yeah.
And it was, every inch of it was sticky.
It didn't look great, to be honest. I mean, have you ever been in a phone box that wasn't sticky?
I don't think I've ever been in a phone box.
No. You sweet summer child. I remember being in a phone box, and I'm not that much older than you, but yeah.
How old are you?
30. Must be the same age, 32?
33.
Are you?
So
I have had a hard day today. I don't look, I look older now. So you met Doofus and things were awry. So, like, the whole thing about the multiverse stuff, like, was there anything that you wanted to see that you didn't see? Of course, we had Princess Sami and Kazuji. We had Vampire Damien Corvin somehow. We had Principal Ian Skinner, which apparently was a bit wilder than was shown on according to Ian himself in an episode that's coming out. So yeah, was there anything that was on there that you were like, oh, can you not just, you know, oh, you find Johnny Lyons from 2010?
I had a lot of ideas. a lot of them I had to be real then, to be fair. But like, I don't know, I wanted I don't know if you want this in, if you want to mention, I don't know. I wanted to have a tag match where it was Jack Morris and Air Miles as the GWO. But it would be like the Disco World Order.
Right.
But strangely, none of them were up for that. What else did I want? I wanted it to be me and Caleb versus Hitler and Sigmund Freud. And then that's how we fixed the timeline, but that was shot down.
I can see why that one was shot down.
Yeah. I'm sure I had more, but
I think the big question is, did you have anyone in mind for other than getting Hitler and Sigmund Freud themselves?
As in other like wrestlers from the past and stuff.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'd say the GWO would have been prime.
I mean, it could be done with Webb as well. He was in it briefly.
Yeah, but I wanted him like bowl cut Webb on the pre show as like newspaper tights. I wanted them. That's what I wanted. But yeah.
I would love to see it. I mean, because I was thinking of characters of people that are on Disco that they could bring back, and of course I was hoping like Hippie Horror would be quite cool. Caleb was
I think originally I was going to do that, and then when the show shifted from Back to the Future to Bill and Ted, and I was like, Ali, me and Caleb need to be Bill and Ted. He was like, oh, okay. So that kind of, I've got literally about a foot away from me all my gears there. I've got the Happy Horror gear sitting in a bag there, so I would have done it, but we ended up being Bill and Ted.
So for yourself, Caleb, I mean, you've been Caleb the whole time, pretty much, but was there any chance? I mean, it would have been very niche for just maybe like a handful of folk in the crowd would have got it, but if you came out in the All About Alan t-shirt again.
I mean, he could have been Future Caleb.
He'd have been Future Caleb. Oh, yeah. Could have been, yeah. That's Hayward. Always an option as well. I wasn't too upset about having to be Bill, though. I've got a little bit of history there as well with the Bill stuff. So slipping back in. If anything, that is kind of like doing a past gimmick for me. So that was okay.
Yeah. When I asked that, I told him what I needed him to do. He sent me a photo of him in the outfit already from like 10 years ago or something.
Yeah,
something and like it's that. A different human being. And I was like, don't ever send me anything if you look like that like ever again. It's bad.
Yeah.
I think they
shouldn't ever be leaked.
I think we've discussed your goth past as well in previous episodes. So there's some pictures, wild pictures out there that'll never be seen.
We'll stick with the most recent pictures of me as Bill. They'll be the pride of place.
So the whole thing, the foundation, the pictures I've seen anyway, the incredible. The whole thing from what Brad I've seen was,
for me, Brad was the absolute hero of that match. He was old man Evans and he had dementia.
He was forgetting everything.
Oh, he was so good. Screaming for his dead wife Monica.
Gets me up for like a slam. He's walking about with me, just forgets what he's doing, puts me down. This is in my house.
This is in my house.
Amazing. He got genuine sympathy when he was like, where's Monica? And I'm like, she's been dead for 20 years. And there's an audible, oh.
Yeah.
What I was confused about by when I was reading Adam's write-up, of course, about it.
I mean, if we're being honest, Adam probably got it wrong, but carry on.
Well, you got Ian's match wrong, and we'll have a rant about that in a couple of weeks on the podcast about it, because he was not happy about being being fingered for losing the match. In that respect, but yeah, the Future Aspen thing,
right? So, right now, I know in his write up he said he couldn't hear what he said, right? But I've watched the footage, right? And I could hear what he said from the balcony, right? So, but anyway, look, I was gonna jump off a balcony, dude comes out, I'm like, who are you? He goes, it's me, Aspen, you from the future. And I go, oh. And he goes, this is a move that ends your career. If you want to save the universe, you need to get down. And I went, thank you, Future Aspen. And then he ran away and saluted. I don't know how else you want me to die.
The whole concept, when I read it, I was like, I don't know how this was done. I thought you may have appeared on a screen or something.
No. Future me ran out through the entranceway. Telling you.
Wrestling is the best.
There was going to be one or two ideas we had involving the screen, but I think on the actual day we couldn't get the screen, wasn't setting up correctly.
So everything just had to completely change, basically.
Yeah, so we just had to go, change.
There was a lot of ideas that didn't make it into the match, which were probably for the best. But
I did
enjoy. My favorite thing, right, is Alan came up to me and he was like, everyone seems to really enjoy the match, blah, blah, blah. Because one guy came up and he went, is the second half going to be less rubbish? And I loved that. That was my favourite thing that happened that day.
I think I genuinely had like five or six people come up saying it was one of the best things they've ever seen. And I was like, okay, cool. And then Alan relayed the same to me about someone saying it was rubbish. And I was like, oh, well. Can't please
is the second
Jim Cornette sitting there like
is the second half going to be less rubbish? And I was like, I couldn't have asked for a better reaction. I'm so happy.
It was one of those things where, from what bits I've seen in that, it could only do it in Discovery. I don't think there's anywhere else in Scotland anyway.
Maybe for now.
I mean, yeah, unless you've got ideas.
I'm not saying anything, but you know.
But if it's like, I think that's actually what's missing. I mean, I was saying like,
there isn't anything in Scotland like that. You've got like Tuesday night graps and stuff like that down in England, where they're doing like a full show that's a school sports day and stuff like that. Right? You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's amazing. I want to do that, but no one up here does it. So there's definitely like a market for it.
There's definitely something there, because at least you can go absolute balls to wall with it and get like, you can have UK tributes, you can have tributes up here and stuff like that, and you can have, I don't know, UK Undertaker, if he's still kicking about, I'm sure he is. You can have UK...
I don't know if he's still doing it, but I'm sure he's alive.
Ah, you can find him.
Will you book Debbie as UK Jack Morris?
Yeah. UK Jack Morris.
So there's so, I think there is definitely a, because everyone's, most places are now doing like, we're wrestling, we're real wrestlers, we're serious wrestlers, and then
exactly. You've
got that, and yeah, there's definitely, I don't know if you were going to be a tribute for anyone, who would
anyone.
You pick? Yeah,
anyone.
Who would be your tribute alter ego?
I don't know. I mean, I guess they've got to be quite a big name, you know, to like, because it needs to be a draw, don't they? But I've been told by multiple people that I look like Trevor Lee, you know, Cameron Grimes.
Mm-hmm.
I could be UK Cameron Grimes, but I don't know. Like, I just want to do stupid stuff. I'll be Cactus Jack.
I was going to say UK expat.
No.
Degeneration X was he called,
no,
wasn't he?
Come on. We've got a UK expat already. His name's Chris Archer.
Chris, I've seen pictures. Is he now Funk? He's now Terry Funk.
Yeah, I don't know what he is, man.
Caleb, who's your you tributing us? Just trim the beard down. Stone Cold Steve Austin. There you go.
For white goatee. Yeah, yeah. I don't know if I would do that. I don't, like, everyone thinks my chin's like down here. My chin actually only ends up here. That's where my chin ends. So I don't know if that would be a good look. That, maybe that. I've had one or two kids go, yeah, like Braun Strowman. I'm like, I'm a lot shorter and smaller than Braun Strowman, but I'll take it. Remember, guys, kids.
Do you remember at Comic Con when Jonathan Geddes kept saying that you look like Batista? And I was like, Batista's not a white man. And he was just mind blown.
Yeah.
Apparently, he looks like Batista.
Well, I mean, that's his name. He commented on YouTube a couple of times that he was asking for a shout out. So that's ticked that off for me. That's nice and straightforward.
There we go.
There you go. He has also told Kaylee that she looked like China.
Yeah, he told Debbie that as well.
Which, I mean, I mean, for Debbie, at least she's got like the black hair and all that kind of stuff. But Kaylee's blonde.
I actually think that might be the only women dresser he knows.
Joni Lawler, of course.
But yeah, Caleb looks like Batista. That's the thing. But the thing is, he was dressed like that.
That's why the entrance started. Gonna come out, get the pyro, give it there. There we go.
I'm all in for it. I don't know. Will pyro work in Aidston?
Not at all, but it's all right.
It'll be very illegal, but.
Yeah, we'll get Malice on the case.
Sparklers or something.
Yeah.
Because they do the old Gilbert entrance, you know, just the wee sparklers and the fire extinguisher just going off. There's money to be made there. We'll speak about that, Aubrey Arake, because we've kind of moved into that a little bit there. We've got a few matches there. We'll kind of litter in as we go on. Of course, your match, we'll leave that until the end. That'll be the kind of main event closing segment because... No point speaking about your match now and then going, what else is happening? We've got, what else? So the first match that was kind of announced after yourselves, actually on the night, was the tag team match, the 2 out of 3 falls between the Fair City Saints, the original GWO, Air Miles and Alex Webb against Foundation.
Miles is going to absolutely hate this.
I would say Google it, but nobody's going to. It's not worth
gonna
it.
He's going to be so unhappy.
He was there against the Foundation of the Future, Bruiser Brad and Ryan Riley, back from the future. They're now young again and huge. They're beefy, broad boys at the moment, and they seem to be getting beefier and broader. 2 out of 3 falls, tag team match. I don't know how you want to do this preview. Do I just like go, what you think is going to happen? What your thoughts on the match in general? Just
It'll be good. I mean, then, like, without being biased in any way, like, I genuinely think that they're the best two tag teams in Scotland just now. So it can't really go much wrong, can it? Especially because you're getting technically to see them have at least two matches. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, Caleb's, any thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, it's a guaranteed banger, is it? You know what you're getting going into that. Money. It's absolute money.
Yeah.
We've seen it a few times now. What's this? It'll be the third time in WrestleZone. I think they've done it once in Fair City. They've done it in Disco. Every time it's been great.
And from what the bits I've seen anyway, like I've seen them the two matches in Wrestle. I saw Christmas Chaos and I saw Regal Rumble, of course, but all their matches seem to be different. They like do something a little bit different. They're not like carbon copy. They're not touring the same tag team match to every show. Like you did back in the day, you'd have two wrestlers that wrestled well with each other and they do pretty much the same match in every promotion and then that would be it. But like the Regal Rumble one, especially with the start with Miles flipping into the ring and then Riley just decapitating him.
That was good.
Amazing.
That was good.
But it's just, yeah, it's two just good tag teams. I don't think they really get the, they haven't really had the coverage. I mean, they've had matches in the Disco and that kind of stuff, but they should be more.
I think people don't seem to realize, like, they see the people that they're around and they don't realize that maybe people elsewhere can be good as well.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like, the psychology-wise of things in their matches and, like, just the structure of their matches and the psychology of it, making sure, like, that it's always, like, the legal person's always the one in for the pins and the way that they, like, just the cool ways that they're, like, cutting off the ring and cutting off the partners and whatever. It's just, like, no one else is actually doing that. Because, like, no, like, even down, like, the stupid little things where it's, like, they're all, every time they're doing, like, tags, they're making sure they're holding the tag rope and both feet are flat on the ground. And it's, like, yeah, that is the rules.
Mm-hmm.
Hold the tag rope, both feet flat on the apron, arm over the top rope. But the amount of, like, time you watch the other tag matches and folk are tagging people's backs, so they're tagging, like, through the rope, so they've got a foot on one of the ropes, so they're not holding the tag rope. And it's like, to me, that's the little, as good as you can be, like, that's the little things that separates you being a good tag team, because then it's like you're actually being a tag team and doing proper tag match psychology. You know what I mean? Like, I don't think anyone else is doing it other than, like, there must be other people doing it, but like to have two teams that are at the level, like, in ring that they are, also totally getting, like, tag team psychology, and it's just more people need to see that.
And to that point as well, I've noticed that. I remember a match, I think it actually was Regal Rumble, where Ryan tagged in, but he missed the tag. So like it's muscle memory. He went in, he missed it. I went, no, I haven't tagged in. He went back out, tagged in properly. It was like just muscle memory as a tag team. It was like, no, it didn't happen. I need to actually go do it.
But that's what it makes complete sense. Like, if you want the match to, if you win the match, right, and it turns out that you weren't the legal man, right, who's to say that no one's going to watch that back and the decision gets reversed later on? You know what I mean? If you're even if you're the biggest villains in the world, you still want to have no doubt that you've won that match. You know what I mean? It makes sense that you would go, oh crap, I didn't actually tag there, I need to make sure that's tagged. It's just, I don't know, I'm just rambling again.
All right. Well, speaking of Foundation of the Future anyway, other than that 6-man tag and what have you, you guys both that was your kind of final four. You had in Regal Rumble involved Bruiser Brad and Ryan Riley was in there. I think for Aspen, it was yourself. It was all three of them. It was Dynamite as well. And for Caleb, it was Bruiser Brad, Ryan Riley, and Damien as your final four. So it's kind of like we're almost mirroring your final journeys in the Regal Rumble before you both came out as victors and that. So it's a nice little mirror point, little added nuance, I suppose, for your showdown.
I mean, we talked about this before.
Our paths.
Like, if you actually look at like everything we've done in wrestling, everything it's just exactly the same the whole way through. Like, the whole, obviously we're both trained at WrestleZone, and then we both started on shows as a bad guy. The crowd essentially turned us. We then, after a while, we started like going other places, and it's exactly the same. It was Discovery and ICW, and then Reckless, and then it's all, and then it's just exactly the same path that we took the whole way. It's kind of cool.
Speaking of that, though, like you say, the crown turned you for you both. I suppose for Caleb as well. It was you were kind of you had Alan to be the guy who was just an absolute buffoon, and you were getting the kind of almost like sympathy off that. But how was it like getting the crowd, hearing the crowd were just with you? They were just starting to really enjoy Caleb as Caleb, and they were almost pleading you at that point, pleading there, to batter Alan.
Yeah, that first show back at WrestleZone, that was a pop for me. Like the crowd were up for me, and not much had changed. Well, a little bit had changed, but you know, overall, came back, it was still the same kind of stories going on. But yeah, like by the time we actually got round to the Rumble last year, and I had enough of Alan, that was fever pitch for the crowd. I think afterwards, Crusher backstage was saying that's one of the loudest reactions he's heard, and I was like, that's insane. I mean, it was also the beautiful thing of being in the Northern Hotel in that venue, being able to encapsulate noise like that. But yeah, that was just the right time, I feel. And the crowd have been with me, well, they were with me before, but then after that they were behind me the whole way.
It's definitely, especially like that whole start of the year though, because you had it would be Summerhill Showdown versus Alan's mysterious injury, and you end up being in the handicap match against Connor and Crusher. And from that match alone, when Crusher, everyone was just, I mean, all you guys were fan favorites, but everyone was going, I think Caleb could win this kind of thing. They're all kind of in your
support. I came close, but those guys were tag champions for a reason at the time, so.
But that was a weird thing, in my corner. Because after the match, Crusher went, "Oh, I'll take you one-on-one in Ellen." I was like, "Oh, I'm going to Ellen then." I was like, I wouldn't have thought of going to Ellen, but as soon as that match was teased and announced, I was like, "Yeah, I think I'm going to get a ticket. I'm going to go drive to Ellen. I haven't been there in a good 10 years, but I'll find the place. I found it by mistake. I was like looking for a place to park. I was like, oh, here's Victoria Hall. Cool. I'll go find a place to park now." But yeah, so the crowd well of support has just been amazing to witness, and to see it from beginning to now to fruition has been just incredible to watch. Aspen, yours a little bit different because you've literally not changed a thing, really.
I've done nothing. I just, like, I don't know. I'm not.
You were away for a bit and you came back?
I'm not acting any different. I'm not. Like, I've never once anywhere had a face turn. I just all of a sudden it's like, oh yeah, you're a good guy now. I'm like, oh, okay. I'm not, but I've not changed how I'm wrestling, how I act or anything. I'm not changed, like, essentially not really. I'm in a singlet instead of trunks, but you know, that's not going to make me a good guy. You know what I mean? But like, I've not changed. I don't know. I honestly don't know. I just changed, I guess, who I'm fighting.
Yeah, I think Discovery is a good example of that, where like,
I've tried so hard to be a bad guy in Discovery. I just can't do it. I was battering women. I was attacking people with turnbuckle hooks. No matter what it was, they were still going for me, and I was like, oh well.
Yeah.
I guess we're Bill and Ted now.
Yeah, we had our little altercation. The crowd were into it, and then next thing you know, we're Bill and Ted, and they're right behind you. They're right behind me.
Yeah,
we've got Johnny Lyons from 2010.
Yeah, I don't know. I just can't. We tried so hard to like just get them to boo me, and it just doesn't work. And I don't know why I can't anymore. I don't know. I guess I guess it's just like once I'm at a place for a while, folk have like the more. Oh, he's an ass, but he's our arse. You know what I mean? He's.
Mm-hmm. And you've done some fairly heinous things in WrestleZone itself.
Yeah. There was a two-year stretch where a 3-year stretch. Yeah, 3-year stretch where like I just was fighting guys in their 60s. You know what I mean? Because I don't know. I just battered like I don't know, I attacked Len Ironside by my chair at ringside, hitting women, making kids cry and stuff. But I don't know. I can't make people hate me anymore. I don't know why.
We've discussed it at length as well. You're not only kids crying, but you've had me crying as well. It shows. So
he's cried. Old women have cried.
Yeah.
I've had emails of complaint from folk in the crowd. But hey, I just walk out now and they're like, Aspen.
we already discussed your return when you came out dressed as Aspen with that hood over yourself, and everyone waited until you took it off, which was an incredible moment in itself. That was quite a big night in general. Again, you were talking about like you've both taken the same journey around about wrestling, but that's kind of where this whole match, that's kind of where the nucleus is, the you returning after a big hiatus, and then Caleb, of course, having that big standout match in the handicap match. So that's kind of where everything. That's where your granite road, really started, as we get to this match. We'll speak about some of the other matches then. We'll go into that. So we've already talked about the tag title match. Great. The other one that's been officially announced at this time is the ladder match, the title opportunity. I'm gonna have to get the names up in front of me because. There's quite a few. It's a very random match when it comes to it. So these are the guys, depending on how your match goes on May 13th, these are your list of potential challengers. And my website's broken, which is ace. There we go. So it includes Dino, Murphy, Tommy Raiden, Zach Dynamite, William Starling, and someone else as well. Just did that off the top of my head. God, I'm having a great time when it comes to technology today.
Have we got Connor?
Connor, that's it.
Connor Molloy.
So it's six potential challengers to yourselves after Aberdeen Anarchy. Is there any? I mean, we're guaranteed William Starling's going to do something ridiculous. He might do one thing during the whole match, and everyone will be going, "Oh my god, he might."
That's probably the only reason he's in there.
Is he the spiritual successor to Mr. Malice?
Mm-hmm. I mean, he could be. Nah, who's going to win?
I think Tommy Raiden's going to die.
Yeah. I don't know.
Dino and Murphy in there.
I don't
together.
Know what Tommy Raiden's done in like a past life, but that boy's just been. Who's he faced so far? He's faced.
Brad, Dino,
Murphy, and now he's in a ladder match with two of them plus William Sterling. Hey, he's done something at training or something, and someone just took offense to it. He has to.
Have you fought him yet? No.
No. I would feel too bad.
Yeah. No.
You saw what happened with Ronan yesterday.
Yeah.
I mean, Tommy might just fold it, huh? I reckon Dino or Connor.
I think that's a fairly good choice.
I would say Dynamite, but I don't think Dynamite will be. I don't think he'll Not that he won't be trying to win, but I don't think he'll have as much need to win because he's already got a belt.
Fair enough. Yeah, Caleb, any predictions for it other than people will die?
Well, yeah, other than that, I mean, you've got Dino and Murphy in together, so that's instantly a numbers game. Everyone's got, I mean, that's two big guys to come up against. So, yeah, that could play into it big time. But like I've seen firsthand this year, the fight Connor's got, he really took it to me in January, so can't write him off. Like Aspen says, Zach's always going to be there or thereabouts, is he? So,
speaking of William Starley being this possible spiritual successor to Malice, because surely he is dead now.
He was there last night.
He was there last night. He tried to interfere. I swear to God.
Yeah.
I turned around. And he was trying to hand a weapon to Dynamite.
Yeah. I asked how he was still alive. Apparently, he's already dead. So,
like, how? Because I was there at Regal Rumble and I saw I saw him fall.
Mike, I was on commentary and the table shook.
So what were you? Either you, what were your thoughts? I mean, because Caleb did the killing twice. That's the second time he's...
Well, I didn't know what was going to happen. So I was on commentary, and obviously I didn't know what was happening. And I saw them there, and I was like, nah, they're not actually doing something. And then I thought, oh, maybe they're going to do, like, you know, the PCO bump on the apron.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, oh, okay, that's still pretty mental, because... Well, and then he just went straight to the floor, and nobody caught him. The last thing I saw before he came off the top was someone looked at Miles and went, "Go catch Malice," and he went, "What?" Malice, not one.
So you did the killing, Caleb. What was your thoughts?
You hit me with a Canadian destroyer. You're gonna get some comeuppance, you know. So
I mean, it was probably the best Canadian destroyer that's ever been done in WrestleZone.
Probably. I've never partook in a Canadian destroyer before that day either, so that was something.
I mean, he did kind of do the PCO bump. Something did bump off the apron.
He hit the apron. His head. I don't think he was meant to hit the apron, but he hit the apron. I don't know. I don't know how much we want to say about it too, but like he's a crazy man. Crazy bastard.
It was just the fact that we thought he was getting attended to, and then suddenly I think it might be Kyle in front of him just went, "Here's Malice." He was just walking at the other side of the ring with just blood back of his head. He was just wandering. I was like, how is he there?
I honestly don't know.
Roll into but the ring and just
as recover. Soon as that happened, I stood up and I couldn't sit back down for the rest of the match. That's how much adrenaline that gave me. I was just like, I can't sit down.
Did you enjoy the match, Aspen? Out of interest. You got a good view.
I got an alright view. I didn't have my glasses on, so I couldn't really see. But I could see outlines and I could hear. But yeah, when he hit the floor, the commentary table shook. And I was like, oh my God. Like, that is some like wave that's come out of his body straight through the floor of this community center. Oh, it was
imagine being downstairs though, just at wherever on the ice rink, and you just hear that massive thud.
There was folk downstairs curling on the ice rink. I know that for a fact. So I don't know what they thought was happening, but yeah, I enjoyed it. Yeah.
I've got the same thought as I did when it happened last time at Regal Rumble. I'm just hoping next time you go to Curl, there's just an outline, just chalk outline on the floor.
Yeah, crazy that it's happened more than once, though.
It's ridiculous. I've still got the gif of it happening the first time. I just love, I say love watching it, but I just love watching it because you just see the camera shake.
The best bit about it is that he landed at his parents' feet and they just no sold it and did not care.
Complete blank. Almost like they were going, he's someone else's problem now.
I don't know why you've got yourself involved in that twice though.
Hey,
eventually it is going to end his life.
Yeah, I'm slightly concerned. Slightly concerned. Well, I've got ideas for next year, but
oh God.
I mean, you're hoping you're not in the match, of course.
Well, that'd be nice. That would be nice. Yeah.
But if the if it does happen, I'm sure Miles is gonna be there as your first challenger. For
yeah, I do like a rumble. I was obviously Damon. He's not been in a rumble for a wee while, so he was actually quite excited about the rumble this year, getting to be in it. And I, you know, similar kind of thing for Aspen. If he's in it next year, I'm sure he'll have missed out on it this year. But we'll see what happens.
Sorry, I was reliably informed that if you did come to our side of the apron, that Kelly would jump over the front row to help you, much like Kyle did for Aspen the year before. So I was told that would happen. I would have loved to see it because that would have just been hilarious for me. But so
we had hey, that she bit. Was moving fast that day. She was moving
oh,
fast.
Absolutely. When I watched the footage back, I think your partner put up, I was like, as soon as it happened, first body, first person up, was just going wild for it. Hearing that reaction though, is it just like, yeah, this feels right kind of thing? That's your year of progression from leaving Allen to winning the Regal Rumble. Was it just, yeah, was that just all feel good?
A bit surreal. You don't know how the crowd's going to react anyways, and you're obviously in there, you know, you're trying to fight and get that reaction. And you know, in this scenario in there with Ryan and Brad initially just trying to survive for a little bit, and the crowd got behind me, got rid of Ryan. The crowd were right behind me at that point. They could tell, I think they could feel it. They could feel something was happening. I could feel it. Powered me through, and I can barely remember what happened with Brad. To be honest, it was such a blur. I say a blur. It was fists and pile drivers. That's what it was. But yeah, that when that reaction went off at the end, yeah, that was goosebump moment for sure.
And you went to a torn muscle as well, didn't you?
Yeah. This bicep
still has it.
Yeah. Well, this bicep is no longer attached down here. It's torn and way up there somewhere. So there was one or two moments hanging on to like the top rope. I was like, ah, you bugger. Had to keep going.
It was just an amazing night. I've enjoyed every show I've been to since the restart. They've just been top quality. And I suppose when you're coming into Dainston, of course, Aspen, you won the title in Dainston Community Centre. So you kind of have that championship experience. Last time that you were in Dainston, Caleb, you lost your hair. A little bit of a contrast. So now you guys are the main event. We'll probably cover that later on, but now you guys are the main event of the show, and it's a lot of pressure to put on you both, but we'll get to that. We'll talk about the rest of the card. So we're going to guess what's the rest of it from last night's
you're
show.
You're gonna guess, because I know.
I'm going to guess the rest of the card, and then everyone's going to look at your faces and see if I'm right. So from last night, and yesterday in general, with it's going to be Mosh Pit Rules against Mickey Vago and Chris Archer. I think that was pretty much declared and confirmed. Just waiting for the little graphic to go out on the old social medias so I can put it on our site. Has to be on Instagram or Twitter though, because WordPress hates Facebook. So yeah, Mosh Pit Rules. The last time this happened, Mosh Pit Rules, it wasn't Aberdeen Anarchy, it was Battle of Nations. So I didn't see it because my son was born, and I was hoping that he would hold on so I could get free tickets for life. So I didn't see it, but it can be a bit wild and chaotic, so which is you guys both like a bit of wild and chaos. Of course, one half of this people above me was partaking in death matches. I don't think it'll be as wild as a death match. But you never know. So yeah, Mosh Pit Rules. Thoughts?
I mean, thoughts in which sense? Who's winning or
just the general, the match, who's winning, what you think, what's
I don't think the only time I can remember Archer being in like a weapons match was against me, him and Vago when beating for the tag titles in the Halloween Brawl.
It's definitely more Viggo's wheelhouse.
Yeah, I think he's got the clear advantage, but I don't know. I mean, Archer's, he's not got as much experience in it, but then I guess that just means that there's no telling what he's going to do. So
yeah, you also don't know what this Chris Archer is. We know who Mickey Viggo is right now.
Yeah. Who is Chris Archer right now? Yeah. I guess you've got to put Viggo as like the favourite.
I think because it's kind of his rules, his match kind of thing. Yeah. But and the flip side, like Undertaker didn't like took ages to win a Hell in a Cell match. So if you're putting the old wrestling logic in there,
did Undertaker ever win a Buried Alive?
Did he? Did he win? No, was it tag? Was it tags? No, I was thinking of the tag match with him and Big Show against Mankind and Rock. But what do you think?
I don't think Taker won a Buried Alive.
He lost that first one against Mankind, anyways, with like the hand coming up through at the end.
Yeah,
they lost against Vince McMahon because of the Nexus in 2003. So. I don't think he's got a good record. And that, so putting that logic in there.
So Vago's losing then?
That's it.
I mean, he won the last one, so we can't really use that logic.
True. I mean, hopefully it goes better. Last time there was a weapons match involving Vago at Aberdeen Anarchy, someone in the front row got hit with a guitar. So
yeah, I mean, that's a frequent thing we're running, so
yeah.
that's probably his fault. I've got an idea for a weapon, though. If any of them are watching this and you want an idea for a weapon, I've got a good one.
Okay. Is it fire related?
No.
No.
When we make a cat of nine tails out of guitar strings. Right. Let's just get like a bunch of guitar strings and then we'll tape the bottom into a handle and use it like a whip.
That silence is just us horrified at the idea of that. Because that's
I'm just putting it out there, you know, if any of them want to try it.
any other ideas for weapons for them while we're here?
I'm still just thinking that high E string is going to really sting.
Oh, yeah.
That tiny little thin one.
Yeah.
That'll be the one. That'll be like a cheese grater.
Oh, yeah. That's what I want. Yeah, maybe, you know, they do them boards and death matches where it's like a board of like foam and then they've got like knives in it, right? But it'd replace the knives with plectrums.
Or like a broken record.
Like a guitar pick board.
Oh, right, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. God, this... I'm getting sore just thinking about all this, the things that could happen. Then last time I saw, it was just like drums and that.
That's what I mean. But like, see if me and Vago had a mosh pit match, I'd be taking it a bit too far, probably.
So is this you kind of half advocating for? Like, didn't they do like Wild Nights Out? Another Wild Night Out in, was it Liquid? I can't remember. I don't know. It's before my rest.
It was in Liquid, and then it was in Liquid again. But it was Institute by that point. Yeah.
So, would you advocate if you had your way, would you have another Wild Night Out?
I mean, I'm not advocating WrestleZone to do it, but someone could do it.
Maybe part of a
anyway, carry wider on.
Thing. Yeah. So yeah, so we're not going to protect who wins because you know everyone's going to have a opinion on what could happen, but. Yeah, so we're thinking Vago does not have the advantage because he's the Undertaker, and Chris Archer does not dress like the Undertaker anymore. So that's what we've learned from that whole thing.
So no one has the advantage. So everyone has the advantage.
There you go. That's probably a better way to put it. So, you know, that's why I've got professionals on this podcast, professional wrestlers. I wouldn't even call myself a professional of anything. Other matches that we think is probably going to happen: Captain Allen. He challenged Deacon Matthews at the Training Academy shows after Deacon threw out Allen. Caleb's got a nice little bit of history with the captain himself.
And the Deacon,
of course, Deacon. Yeah. Will this
Deacon,
match
my
actually
good, my
happen?
Good friend.
It's
So I can tell this will be a lot of fun. First and foremost, like, as much as Alan's annoying and he's done some very wrongs to me, he is a lot of fun at times. Like, there was such a long period where I was fed up with his nonsense, but it was always so entertaining or fun to just be doing, to be involved in his nonsense, that it carried on a little bit longer. Like, I was like, okay, maybe we'll see how it goes the next month. You know, he kept entertaining me, to be honest. And this will be more of the same, but with my good pal Deacon there to beat him up instead of me this time. Sounds good to me.
Good fun. Aspen, I'm not sure, because I'm again terrible researcher here. Did you ever get your one-on-one match with Alan?
No, still not there. Maybe one day. I've still never wrestled him.
That's a damn shame.
That's the only thing off my list from Summer Hill Showdown.
So yeah, Captain Alan. Yeah, he's what can you say about Alan that he hasn't already told himself about anything? Captain Ghost, as I like to call him, because he keeps, every so often he'll message me going, right, we're doing this podcast, and I go, right, okay, when? And that's it. That's the conversation, stone dead. He does not get back to me after that. It's like he's just like waits and just goes.
He's breadcrumbing you.
He is. He's reeling me in. You know, C related. He reels me in, and then it says, I go, yeah, okay. Just like throws me back out, and then he'll cast me again at some point. So I hope the Deacon bars him, just for that alone.
My prediction is Alan is going to ride to the ring on a boat.
That would be incredible. It's like,
that's my prediction.
Like an actual physical boat, or is he going to bring?
Yeah. Do you remember when they carried? Was it Malice? They carried to the ring on a throne.
Right, okay.
But imagine that, but it's a boat, and it's for like young boys dressed as little sailors.
That's it. That's it. If it doesn't happen now, we'll just be disappointed. I mean, the match will be good, but if there's no boat,
I've been trying to get a...
Yep.
Sorry, I've ruined it for everyone.
That's all right.
Yeah. I'm also trying to get an Alan Sterling t-shirt to happen.
I think he could probably still sell a few.
I just want
all his face on it.
I just want out. No, I want an Alan Sterling toot toot t-shirt.
Have you already kind of broached him with some ideas? Have you got some designs that you've already sent him? Going, right, this is the one.
I've got ideas in here. I've got ideas in here. No, they're just in my brain. But I just want, I don't know. In my head, it's like a proper like 1920s, 1930s, like you know, like Steamboat Willie,
right? Yeah, yeah.
Like the original Mickey Mouse, right? Like that style of cartoon, but it's Alan, and it says "Toot Toot, Alan Sterling." That's all I want.
Amazing. I would probably buy it. Although I'm getting rapidly, I know I'm going to be skint come Anarchy, because of course I've pre-ordered the cool Granite Road T-shirt, which will be, the pre-orders will start by the time this episode goes out. So I've already pre-ordered that. Two of them, because Kelly has to have one. She's already dibbed wearing it at the show, so I'm buying a t-shirt for what I won't even wear at the event it's happening at.
You guys could wear them both together.
You can match. What's wrong with that?
I've already been told. I've suggested matching t-shirts and that for a very long time, and it's always been shot down, mainly because
I've right. But if you put on the t-shirt, what's she gonna do? She's not gonna want to take off her one.
Ah. True.
Put another t-shirt on top of your t-shirt, get to the venue, take your seat.
There we go, just skulk off the toilets for a bit and just come back. It's on. So you can't,
yeah.
You can't, I've thrown away the other t-shirt. You can't do anything about it. Not even matching, because I went, oh, I'll wear my, I've got a grey Caleb t-shirt. She's got a red one. It's like, oh, we'll wear that. She goes, no, that's too close. So just, we're not going to be one of those matching couples in clothes, which, you know, disappoints me greatly, because I want to be that old couple that wears the matching max. You know,
we just have to hope Kyle and
I just
Kaylee
want
do it
the,
then.
yeah, I just want the entire front row to be in the same t-shirt.
Like the old when it was all Austin 316 or all NWO,
Yeah, that's what I
then
want.
General Europe.
It's all Granite Road.
Yeah, that'd be good. That'd be good. I don't know
And
if we'll have. We don't think we'll have enough t-shirts
still
for
have enough for
everyone.
everyone, but
Yeah.
I reckon we'll have an okay amount left on the day, but there's been a lot of pre-orders,
Yeah.
so.
Thank you, everyone.
It's a cool t-shirt. I mean, your last year, I mean, after the one you didn't like, the Monster Can one, the ultraviolet
Yeah.
one. Since then, the t-shirts, I mean, the Grand Slam t-shirt is amazing, which.
It's going to be taking more time on them because I'm like, I don't want to get another t-shirt printed that I'm not happy with. But I messaged Caleb and I was like, do you want to do like a joint t-shirt? And he's like, yeah. And then I was like, here you go. Just here's the design.
But it's just, I love that kind of t-shirts though, because it's like you get the Aberdeen Anarchy one each year, has the logo, has the matches on the back. But like for the WrestleMania t-shirts, that you get like the back. You see, like Primark or that sometimes do them where they have like Royal Rumble 2000, they have that,
Yeah.
they have the Cactus Jack Triple H one, which I want, and I'm just not willing to pay postage. That's kind of, I want to find it in the wild and then go, yes, that's mine. But I love that kind of style t-shirt. It's of its time because it's for a specific event, but it still looks cool that you can wear it at future shows as well.
Yeah.
Yeah,
And it's
so
also like you were there. You were there when that happened.
that's
Yeah.
you can't take home a chair, but you can take a t-shirt with the date on it.
I mean, you could take on a chair, but I don't know if the venue would be happy with it.
Just don't let anyone see you.
That's, I mean, that could be future. Future, just get front row seats. You pay your £3 extra, and you get to take home a seat. There you go. That's the deal.
But then you've got to take it with you the next show you go to, though. So
I bring your own
take it
seat.
every time.
Yeah, that might not. It could work. Just imagine everyone. I mean, everyone. That means I'll get a seat outside the queue, and then inevitably don't open the doors on time. So it's fine.
And it would save our staff from setting up all the seats, so setup would be quicker. Yeah.
This is there's no bad ideas here. This is
No.
all good stuff. So
Progressive.
wrestle management, bring your own chair shows. That's
You
the
can bring a
idea.
bean bag if you just want to have a bean bag. It'd be wacky and zany. You
Bring
don't have to
actually,
necessarily.
it's actually not a bad idea. You know, you run a show and just be like, instead of BYOB for bring your own beer, you do BYOC, bring your own chair. And everyone's on like high chairs, and that'd be funny.
So you got camping ones, just kick stools, and
Yeah. You
just
just know someone would bring out like five mates would turn up with sofa, like a corner sofa.
absolutely. Or if someone takes an inflatable one but haven't inflated it, so they're before the show, they're just there kind of just
Yeah.
going try to blow it up. This is excellent. This is all great ideas. Maybe we should just cut this bit out, just keep it for ourselves for future. Other match, I don't know what's happening because it'll be announced. I'm assuming something's happening with Mr. WrestleZone and Omar against Rhys Dawkins and Brian Tucker. Some sort of maybe tag team match, maybe, or something.
You would hope so.
Yeah.
Mr. WrestleZone, did you have the pleasure
Yeah.
to meet Mr. WrestleZone?
Yes. I took a photo of him and Omar Mohammed together. He seemed very excited to meet me because I had a belt.
He is an excitable kind of guy.
And
If he is
any,
a guy, could be a female, I don't know.
oh, you never know. Yeah, progressive. That's the world there. Any thoughts on who he could be? Of course, I've put out my thoughts. He's Jimbo Bannon, but so any ideas who could be Mr. WrestleZone?
Don't know. Maybe I think he, I well, I was just given information from my sources on commentary, you know what I mean? So I was at the Rumble and I was just letting the DVD owners at home know that he was trained at the Thunder Wrestling Academy under Blue Thunder, you know? And he's a So I think he's just a new trainee. That's what I was told.
Right, okay.
To start with, Lewis Turner on security wasn't at the venue, and Mr. WrestleZone was going around. So I thought, oh,
Could be him.
But then Lewis did turn up a bit later. I was like, oh, that's that theory gone.
See, I brought
was
up
told
on.
he's I was told he's actually 6 years old.
Wow.
Wow. It's incredible.
I don't know whether how true that is, but I was told he was six, and that's why he was allowed into training, because he just had a growth spurt, and they were like, you know what, you look, your body's grown early enough, you've got like gigantism or something.
Yeah.
But he's actually six.
Yeah. You know how we are up in Aberdeen. We're obsessed with the big beefy boys. Hoss County up here.
I mean,
I
it
mean,
is Aberdeen horse country.
he did bring up that, of course, you didn't see Lewis there at first. You thought it might have been him. One person that wasn't at the show, I mean, he's already had his shout out, but Jonathan Geddes was at the show. And, you know, he's at every show nearabout.
Yeah.
And
Mr. Wrestlezone didn't have a waistcoat, though.
no.
well, maybe that's just his disguise. Once Jonathan takes off the
He's got
waistcoat,
two cape. He's got two capes, though.
that actually was a little bit irritating to watch, this little cape. I was like, it's not even matching color. What's that? This is very irritating to look at. It's not even blue. It could be blue. Get him a blue cape or a red cape or a silver cape, but not purple. It
Look,
was.
right? That's his ring cape. He's got an entrance cape, and he's got a ring cape.
The
He's
entrance
only.
cape's too long. It's not safe for doing
See when
stuff
they're
in the ring.
That age, right? You've just got to let them dress how they want, just express themselves. You know what
He's
I mean?
only six. He's only
Only
six, and here
six.
you are slagging off his cape.
Mean, this is just all rumor that he's six. I mean,
Oh, true.
I was a
We don't know.
reliable source.
Right, okay. A Scottish Dave Meltzer type that had all this information.
No, an
No.
insider source.
Okay. Someone actually has information. Cool.
Yeah, an insider source, yeah.
Rhys Dawkins and Brian Tucker, then. Two of your favorite people in the world.
I love them. I love those
We beat
guys.
them at
Yeah.
Commodore.
Yeah. We had the first ever WrestleZone taking tag match.
True story.
We got in the ring. Rhys and Tucker didn't want to wrestle me or Aspen. So instead of a tag match, they wanted to have a taking tag match. Which I
Which
didn't know what taking tag
we
was,
needed to
so
explain to Caleb what taking
yeah.
tag was.
So then they
But
started tagging each other back and forth, and then they were chasing each other around the ring. They got back in the ring. Me and Aspen started beating them up a little bit. And then Tucker tagged me. I was furious at that. Chased him around the ring, and we were all running around the ring again. And it was all nonsense. Then we did some actual beating them up. And
yeah, and then right at the end, we both gave them a good old overhand big show tag, and 1, 2, 3.
so this wrestling at the Comic Con, then there's lots of fairly big names about, like your Hacksaw Jim Duggins and other people from other things that I haven't watched. Did any of them come up to the show? Did any of them come in and see you
Yeah.
watch
Yeah,
it, or
some
Leah
dude from The
Thompson
Walking
loved it.
Dead was filming me versus Omar. I don't know, I've never seen Walking Dead, but he was filming me versus Omar.
I
He
think there was
was.
a Doctor Who loving it at one point. I think
Yeah.
David Wilson was there and was excited about that. I didn't particularly know who he was
There
either,
was
but
Doctor Who watching.
yeah, Thompson was watching and
Jim Duggan just kept coming around going, "The boys are the boys." Well, it was, yeah.
was nice when he met you again, though.
Yeah, he kept telling everyone that was stiff. He
He's
started
not
calling
wrong. He's not wrong.
he started calling me Stiffy. He's like, "Hey, Stiffy, come get a photo, Stiffy." I'm like, "Okay."
Does it mean the same here that it does across the pond? I don't know.
I'm assuming he was just talking about, how hard I'm hitting people. That's my
Hacksaw's.
NXT name, though. That's my NXT name, Stiffy Duggan.
That's it. Yeah, you're the lineage of Hacksaw Jim.
Yeah, Stiffy Duggan.
That. Did you watch Hacksaw's Jim Duggan's adventures in Aberdeen? It was very wholesome and just very nice to watch him be
Really
ambushed by a
excited that he
double
was on
decker
the top
bus.
of a double decker, yeah. Okay.
It was nice. I like hearing the stories of
I've
as you
got
guys call him Uncle Jim.
I don't really know how I've ended up with it, but I've got this sitting behind me. And this is the pull-up banner from behind his desk at the Comic-Con.
they just suddenly appear and they just go,
no, it was just in my house one day, and it's signed by Jim Duggan, and I'm like, okay, cool. I don't really know how I've got it, honestly, but yeah.
So if anyone's looking for it, just look away. Nothing happened.
So I got the pull-up banner there, and yeah, I got a recreation photo of the punch photo from the newspaper. So, and he kept zooming in on my phone, showing people my face and going, "That's a good worker. That's a good worker." Yeah, and then it dawned on me that I was dressed head to toe in a SpongeBob outfit, and I was like, "Oh well, this photo is not the best type to get this photo, but."
Leah Thompson, you mentioned, of course, Back to the Future. I have actually seen Back to the Future. From my research, it's Connor Malloy's favourite film. So yeah, Leah Thompson is enjoying the show.
Yeah, she came back specifically to ask to get a photo with everyone.
That's nice.
And it was as I was getting changed, so there's a photo out there of everyone, and I've got one shoe on, one sock. Why has this happened?
Would you want it any other way?
Well. No, she came back and she was like, she was going about how we're better than half the stuntmen that she uses on films, and I was trying to get a booking on a film, and I don't think it's going to happen.
Just go from Howard the Duck to you with one shoe on. What a career. Leah Thompson. Yeah. Amazing. I think we do have a question about it, though. I think it is, anyway. We've got from Omar Muhammad.
Mm-hmm.
Ask the guys if they planned on attempting to wipe out the crowd when they threw me at Dynamite and that during the Rumble Six Man.
Oh yeah, that was it. That was at the Royal Rumble. We double gorilla pressed him and threw him onto a wheelchair.
Now coming back to me now, because there was a lot of oh no when they landed on there. On that. Omar did a lot of getting thrown around in that particular
match. He landed, and I was like, oh. And then I saw the boy holding his ribs, and I was like, I'm just going to turn my back on this.
He's lighter than we expected, I think, there.
Yeah, but then on the way, as we're leaving, going back to the curtain, I did say to everyone, go just say sorry to him. I feel bad now. But I didn't realize he was going to fly that far.
I think I
jumped out of the way as well, so we were lucky that
the whole crowd kind of had that kind of same reaction. I was like, "Oh," and I just turned away from it. It's like,
legitimately, like when you watch it back, he hits it, and I just turn my back and just walk back to the other. I'm like, "Nope, I'm not getting involved."
Front row at a Rumble's a splash zone, though, so I was just teasing for what was waiting to start happening, just making sure. You know, you're dispersed enough from the ring to safe landings and all that. But
yeah. So we picked our side.
I saw the first time he's taken someone to his wheelchair, though. There was a triple threat. It was me, Dynamite, and Tucker in Stonehaven. And Dynamite did a dive. And he dives and he hits me. And I go up the aisle. A Dynamite goes to the side and just lands like the wheel of this wheelchair just hits him like square in the middle of his thigh, and he can't walk the rest of the match, and then he just had this massive black bruise all like from top to the bottom of his thigh for ages. Well, he's all. If you want to park your wheelchair there every time, right in front of the aisle, you know people are going to be diving. Sorry. Yeah.
Hug a corner. Take the corner.
Yeah.
No one's diving over the corner.
He was there last night, and Ronan King told him he was on death's door.
Yeah. I did that. Kirsten Louise, who took a lot of photos, put that as a quote. I was like, Jesus, Ronan.
Yeah. He kept giving Ronan, and Ronan was like, "Look, mate, shut up, you're on death's door." I was like, "Oh my god, oh my god."
He is some lad, that Ronan King. I'm guessing he's going to be against Damien in some sort of
format.
Yeah. But yeah, he's got some sort of, I mean, you were talking about like how Adam didn't hear Future Aspen say anything. It plays back in my mind that I didn't even hear him swearing in his in one of his first matches at Summerhill.
Which time though?
the one at Summerhill where I was front row and literally like 2 meters away, and everyone turned and went, "Did he just swear?" And I went, "No, I didn't hear anything." And then I saw the footage back. How I missed it, because it was literally next to me, him swearing. But yeah, he's got some. At least he stopped swearing at folk, I suppose.
Yeah.
He was in Kelly's bad books.
He hasn't hit anyone for a while either in the crowd, so he's getting there.
He was in Kelly's bad books for a while because we went to see the Trinity Centre show, and before his match, I think it was the Rumble match main event, he came up and he was handing out little pictures of himself, because of course he was, and he turned to us like, "Oh, when I win this," it was a triple threat actually, it was in a title match. He went, "I'm going to win this belt. It's going to be even more beautiful than your son is," and he left. And Kelly's like, "I want him to fucking die. Stop. I'm the one to swear. I want him to die in this match now, because you said that." And I'm like, "Ah, but he's good, eh?" And he was like, "No, I want him to die in this match. If he could, that'd be nice." So she still likes him, but it was a very touch and go moment. It was like 2 months after he got out of hospital, and he's like, "Oh, more beautiful than that son you've got." So yeah, Ronan, we've already mentioned that you parted a bit. Ronan and Damien, it's gonna be hard hitting, I suppose. Yeah. That's probably the best way to put it.
Yeah, I mean, I can see it being more fast paced flips and stuff. Like a good like cruiser match. That's why
he's got a history of messing with people's kids, though. It seems maybe cut that. We're dealing with Scottish wrestling here, but the Rumble show, you know, he was prodding the bear a bit, antagonizing his daughter and everything. It's like, well,
yeah, maybe she'll.
That's one. Yeah, well, I'd be worried about that. I reckon she's got a good punch on her. I reckon she's ready to go.
Oh yeah,
antagonizing Billy's wife about
his, she told me one time that if Dynamite kept cheating to beat her dad, she was gonna have to step up and do something about it. And I was like,
I'd pay to see that.
So I mean, it could happen.
I know. What age is the kids' classes?
Yep. I couldn't tell you.
Yeah. One day she's going to turn up at the training academy. Just start
12, maybe? I don't know.
Start battering 13. Everyone.
Yeah. But she was 100% serious. She was going to have to step up and do something about it if he kept cheating. So I was like, well, and now Rory's specifically picked on her.
Someone's like the Lita Harakarana. We'll just look up and it'll be Damien's daughter on the top rope, just waiting to interfere in the match. That'll be something. Hopefully, if we don't get the boat, then hopefully we get that instead. We'll get Ronan getting battered by a little girl. I think that's the way. Right, before we talk about your match, the main event, we don't know what else is happening. I don't even know what's announced, if there is an hour match. I think that's just about all of them, if not all of them. We've got to do the Manscaped ad, and I will try and keep it as brief as possible, because from this one going forward, they don't get any better, because they're just terrible. So
do we need to be involved in this? Because I'm probably not the best advert for Manscaped.
Are any of us really? I mean, Caleb's got a nice chin. You mean your beard's looking all right? Caleb's got a nice beard.
Yeah, I'm pretty smooth everywhere else. Right?
He's smooth everywhere, and I'm very much not.
Well, no, I don't know what you need then. Support for SWN is brought to you by Manscaped, who are the best in men's below the waist grooming. Their products are precision engineered tools for all your family jewels. That's a terrible read for me. Manscaped's performance package, the ultimate men's hygiene bundle. You can join 8 million men worldwide who trust Manscaped with this exclusive offer for you. 20% off with free shipping with the code, SWN20 at manscaped.com. And, you know, it's all good. There's loads of good stuff on there. I've got the kit. I've tested it out. It definitely does what it says on the packaging. It's good stuff. It really is. They've got ball deodorant, toner, trimmers, weed whackers.
What is ball toner, by the way?
I don't know, but it feels nice. That's all I can tell you.
So have you tried the whole gimmick, the whole
package?
I've
tried everything except the nose and hair trimmer and nose and ear trimmer, because I'm not that old yet to need it. But when was it? Crop preserver, ball deodorant. That's nice.
Crop preserver.
Yeah, I know they're pretty good. But the ball toner, I don't know, is you give it a couple spritz and you're
read
good.
What it says it does on it on the bottle. Come on. Alex Webb's advert for Manscaped was better than this. You can do better. Come on, read it out.
We're intrigued here. Come on, sell it to us.
Well, I mean, Alex Webb's got a massive plaque, so he's earned his
he needs Manscaped for his massive plaque. Anyway.
He's Manscaped for his massive bald spot as well. Right. most views on TikTok is me just roasting him about his hair. Like, I'm the one that could judge him on that. Right, so for any time, pick me up, spritz your goods once or twice, let air dry.
That's the instructions. What does that mean, though?
Pick me up, yeah, I mean...
There's no instructions on air. It's just this old advanced groin care. Hang on.
Advanced groin care?
Yeah, I'll go down.
We'll Google it, yeah.
I've got the whole read here. It's fine. That doesn't even help. Their crop preserver ball deodorant and crop reviver ball toner will change the way you approach your hygiene routine.
Crop reviver ball toner.
I think it just makes everything soft down there. Not everything. The hair. It makes the hair soft down there and the skin.
I mean, surely it's naturally soft.
I don't know, I'd be surprised.
A little bit wiry.
Not that I have a lot of experience seeing other men's. This is a hole I'm not wanting to dig myself into. But I'm not like I've experienced seeing other men's crops. But I assume that can be a bit hairy and wiry down there. So if that's the ad. I don't think they're renewing it.
Whoa, 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 whoa. What's the code again, Billy?
Oh, SWN20, manscaped.com. Go and get 20% off and free shipping. Their pants
manscaped.com
really nice
is the website. That's not part of the code. The code's just SWN20. So there you go. Good work. Yes.
Done.
Right. Yeah, they didn't pay me for that. They just gave me a nice, they gave me the cool kit, which it works, but I don't think they're renewing the ad anytime soon. Anyway, right. The main event. Let's get into it. It is the Regal Rumble winner for 2023, Caleb Valhalla, against the undisputed WrestleZone champion, Aspen Faith. It has divided this house very much in half because Jack's not getting an opinion just yet, even though he owns two Caleb Valhalla vests, which may be swaying his way. This is the big one. This is the match I wanted as soon as kind of we were getting into Regal Rumble season and Aberdeen Anarchy season. This was my prediction. This is the match I wanted, and we're getting it. It's the one time I've been right in predictions for a very long time. I don't know what you guys want to talk about, particular match, the journey. What's your thoughts and opinions? I'll start.
You're the journalist.
I'll start with Aspen then. When you won, when you watched,
you wanted the match, Billy.
Hey, you're the journalist. You're the journalist here. Come on.
Okay then, Aspen. When you saw the finish of the match,
yes.
When you saw Caleb won, initial thoughts then, thinking this is going to be your opponent at Aberdeen Anarchy.
Yeah, cool. When I was on commentary and it was the last four, I was like, I've never beat Caleb. It's like, those two are big boys. Let's go with Damien. And then he got eliminated. And I was like, right, you know what? Let's just go with Caleb because the other two I can't be arsed with. I mean, that's essentially what I said on commentary. So,
but you witnessed him kill a guy, but like 10 minutes beforehand.
Yeah, but you know,
but it was malice.
It was malice. I'm probably about 20 times, you know, sturdier than he is. So, I'm cool with it. Let's have a fight. You know, Discovery Wrestling don't want to let us fight.
Yeah, I mean, you saw we've had a few tussles. We had a little brawl at Discovery. We got pulled apart. We had to then save the timeline, and then once we did, we got to fight again. I think we just like fighting each other, and I think the crowd up in Aberdeen want to see us fight each other. I don't think there's been many Anarchy main events like this, like where you've got two fan favorites actually going against each other. It's something different. It's something interesting.
There's no animosity or anything. There's no, I think people yesterday were like, oh, Caleb's gonna, he's gonna attack Aspen or whatever. And no, we just
Yeah.
high-fived and then like there's no, it's not like we're in a, we're, it's not like we're having a rivalry or we're not, you know, we're
Want to
just,
fight each other, but
we're gonna have a fight and see who's, you see who comes out on top, who's
yeah.
the better man.
I'm trying to think last time that that was the case, that it wasn't like it was just a straight up good guy or bad guy main event. Probably was it Swift Crusher, maybe? Can't remember what year though. 2015, something like that,
There
maybe.
was still, I think there was still a bit of, you know,
Mm-hmm.
Crusher was being, definitely being antagonistic, but like we're not even, don't know.
We've team
At
set
some
up, I
point,
mean,
I'm going
we
to have to do a promo on the match, and I don't know what I'm going to say because I'm not going to tell him he's rubbish. Who
Yeah,
knows?
I mean, yeah, it's one of those. You can't say I'm rubbish. I beat you in January, but I can't say anything. I mean, you're the champion. You're obviously the best in WrestleZone right now. You wanted to find who was a worthy challenger. I
There you
want to
go.
face the best. I want a shot at that Undisputed Championship. It's nothing. There's nothing better. We've teamed several times. We teamed at Comic Con. We teamed at the Rumble before the actual Rumble. We teamed last night. And yeah, every time it's been fun.
Honestly, if it was like if Brad had won or if Ryan had won, there would be something there that, you know, there'd be some sort of heat there that we need to work through, but there's, we're just gonna have a have a match, and
See who's the best
as
on that
boring as
day.
that sounds, it's gonna be a, it's gonna be a fight.
I mean,
That's what Granite Road's all about.
you say as boring as it sounds. Like I say, this is the match I wanted, and like you're saying, it is just two guys that just like to fight. There's no real connection between you other than you've tagged a few times, and there's no, let's say, animosity. But as far as it comes to WrestleZone, we see guys that are just in the Northeast, and that's it. They maybe venture to Fair City if maybe, but you two are guys that have certainly. You've now done the journey, like you're on the Granite Road. You've been to the same places just about, and you're just two of the biggest fan favorites in WrestleZone right now. I mean, maybe up until Christmas
Two.
Chaos, there was
Yeah.
Swift was up there, but of course now he's gone. So that you
Yeah, I mean, it's like you're saying, like we wrestle all over the place. We're two of the biggest fan favorites. We're the top two merch shifters. Like you, like it, if that's, this is he, they, everyone wanted him to win the Rumble, but it wasn't even like a question. That's what they wanted. So yeah, there's no like, oh, we hate each other, but both still want to win. And if you're looking, not even like just the rest of the card, if you're looking at the rest of the WrestleZone for like the last year or whatever, you're probably not going to see a harder hit match than what's going to happen in Anarchy. It's going to be a fight.
And there's no bells or whistles, there's no stipulation, there's no, it is literally just gonna be two guys
Two boys fighting.
fighting.
That's wrestling,
Yeah, it's best in its purest form, I suppose. I don't think I got your thoughts, Caleb, though. So what were your thoughts? You won the match, you knew who your next opponent was in the near future. It was gonna be Aspen. Of course you like a fight, you guys have been fighting in other promotions and tagging as well. So yeah, here was your thoughts as soon as that settled in, that thought settled in.
Yeah, it was starting to settle in when he got in the ring with that belt and offered his hand and let's go. That's the only thing that was in my head. Wasn't really sure what was planned for the training academy at that point, and then when it was announced we were teaming together, it was great fun. Get to fight alongside him again, and
Which I feel like, just as a side note, I feel like they've made that match at the Academy show with the purpose of trying to cause some sort of
yeah,
rift.
friction.
Like, oh, let's see what, happens. But no, we just fired two boys, one, and then high five.
Yeah, but I mean, like you said, that people want to see it. I want to see it. Aspen, I think, was wanting the best, and I think on that night I was the best, and We'll see at Anarchy when it comes down to me and him, you know, who's the best on that night. And I think this is one of those that I know, he knows, this could go either way on any night.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to take him to his limit. He's going to take me to my limit. And that's what he wants. That's what I want. It's the biggest night of the calendar year for wrestling at WrestleZone. It's the night you give everything. And we'll see what we've both got. It's exciting.
Genuinely, I can't wait for it, because I've been at the edge of my seat, of course, for Aspen's journey when he came back and was having the title matches and not quite getting there because of reasons, usually due to the foundation in the future. But to this match is the one I'm going to just be the most tense for. I think it's probably the most tense one-on-one match I'll ever be sitting through, because it will go either way. There's no like voice in the back of my head going, oh, this is what's going to happen, this is who's going to win. Because even for last year, the main event, the triple threat, I was like, I want Aspen to win, but my voice in my head was going, it's going to be Zach, though. It's going to be Zach who's going to win. And I'm like, no. But this year, I'm thinking, I don't know. I genuinely do not know. There's no swaying in my head. Of course, my heart says one thing, my brain's like fogged at the same time. Going, no, I'm not helping you with this. I don't know either. Which makes it even more exciting. So like I say, it's not got the animosity. It's not got the you're a wrong end, I'm gonna batter you. It's gonna be, yeah,
it's competition.
Yeah, it's gonna be amazing. I feel like
everyone's gonna win. And we just have to look at how quick the tickets have sold, how people are coming from all over the country to come see the show.
Five tickets left right now.
I think there's even less. I think there's down to two.
Is it?
It'll be sold out by the time this episode goes out. So we're doing a big sell for a show that everyone's got tickets for anyway.
I forgot that this wasn't live.
we got our physical. Well, I already bought my physical ticket. I was raring to go, and then after Caleb won, first Kelly jumped out of her seat. We had to buy a second one. So that's our first Anarchy for, I think it was about 5 years, 6 years maybe. So she's well excited for it, and we've already arranged babysitter and all that. We were just yeah, it's going to be amazing. Outside of your match though, what's your kind
of seconds? I've got a cat scraping at a door.
Okay. Well, I've got you here on your own then. Kelly did have a question: is where do you get your face paint from? Because she was amazed that you went through the whole match of the Rumble and the six man earlier, and it didn't seem to budge.
The war paint is good. It's good stuff. I can't remember exactly where this brand is from, but yeah, it's designed not to come off, because I don't want to get it all over people's gear.
That's the worst, by the way.
Yeah,
I've had Damien's face smeared on my thighs and stuff.
Yeah, no. The stuff I use is all alcohol based. So, like, I got home last night. I had a drink or two. Thought, right, I'll maybe start getting ready to go, unwind and go to bed. Went to the toilet. In the mirror, there's my face paint staring back at me. Still, I was like, oh yeah, should maybe take that off before I go to bed. But yeah, it's all alcohol based, so it doesn't rub off. You can't just wash it off with water or soapy water. You've got to use actual like oil based remover stuff to take it off. So I don't want to get it on people's gear, especially like last night with Rowan and his gear is all white. It would have been a disaster.
Yeah,
I get quite sweaty.
I'm going to bring some rubbing alcohol to Anarchy and just...
Oh, my powers!
So, yeah, before we wrap up the show then, we've really talked about the journey in the show. I'm glad. This is a very exciting episode 200 for me, because I've not been secretive in saying that you two are my favourite wrestlers in the country right now. Definitely both in the top five, probably just top two anyway. If we're looking at the rest of the card though, outside of your match, what's the one that you're going to be like, try and look through the curtain to watch? What's your kind of match of the night?
Tag match.
Yeah. It's hard to look past titles. That tag match. Yeah, the tag title matches.
And then the mosh pit. Because I like weapons matches.
The ladder is going to be chaos as well. The ladder match is going to be chaos.
Yeah. I don't know how they're going to attach the contract, whoever it is they're doing to the roof. It's a high roof, isn't it?
Not for us to worry about.
Send Malice up there, it'll be fine.
Yeah, just to have him dangling, holding a contract.
But yeah, I think the 2 out of 3 tag match for me.
That could
anyway.
Be the show stealer for sure. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think if I'm not a booker in any sense of the word, but I think that's your opener, like, or the ladder match. But I think that would be
I think first half main.
Yeah. They've definitely earned a main event.
Open with a ladder. First half main. Reopen the second half with the mosh pit, and then us in the main. That's what I would do.
I reckon.
But I'm not a booker.
It'll be mosh pit before. I reckon it'll be mosh pit before the interval, just for cleaning up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or before the raffle.
Oh yeah, that could be.
Okay. I just reckon. To me, there's two title matches on the show, and they should be the two mains.
Yeah.
But that's I'm not a booker.
So it's a little bit of a shame the Tri-Counties isn't being defended, but.
I know that was again, when that ladder match popped up, I was like, this is a bit of an odd match, but I'm gonna enjoy it probably, because I'm a big bitch for WrestleZone pretty much. I'll just enjoy what you give me most of the time. So anyway, so thank you for joining me today for episode 200. I'm so excited, so appreciative that you guys have taken the time and taken quite a bit of time to speak to me about this match, this show in general. Is there anything at all you want to throw out there before we stop recording and go on our merry way?
I don't know. Buy our merch.
Yeah, you've missed out on tickets for Anarchy if you've not bought them by this point. So
that's true. That's to be
you can't really flag that. So yeah,
Buy
our merch.
Don't know. Just get yourself ready for Anarchy. Watch some old Japan matches, and that'll get you somewhat warmed up for the main event.
Excellent. Well, great. Well, thank you very much for taking time to speak to me again. Have a good one.
Let's go.